Examine free.
In 1888, Sir Henry Halford, captain of the English 8, exhorted the country gentlemen of England to take up high-class rifle shooting, both as a sport and as a business. Today, the term gentleman may be a trifle elastic, but there's no doubt that match rifle is still the most exclusive form of shooting, and the only one which is peculiarly British. This is the annual prize meeting of the Cambridge University Long Range Rifle Club, founded in 1864. The membership is open, with a few notable exceptions, only to those who were formerly at Oxford or Cambridge.
Shooting at ranges over 1,000 yards is a scientific business and a contest with the elements. Temperature is one of the more critical factors. At 1,000 yards, for every 10 degrees Fahrenheit, the firer must correct his aim by about a foot on the target. One of the many calculations meticulously noted by a firer and translated to a micro-adjustment on the backside. The normal bullseye is only 2 feet in diameter and is very difficult to hit consistently at 1,200 yards. Judging wind speed and direction are unquestionably the greatest challenge to the marksman. And if conditions are tricky, staying on the whole target, only 10 feet wide by 6 feet high, is challenge enough. Barometric changes are at least as significant. If beyond 1,200 yards, even such factors as the rotation of the earth must be taken into account.
There was a puff just about the time you fired, and it had fallen off, I thought.
Each firer is on his own. Each one is attempting to build up an overall picture of the wind. Above all, the maximum and minimum allowances he must make. When foxed, he can at least set the mean.
Mr. de Havilland, bullseye 5. Next to fire, Mr. Robinson.
Although the pleasant survival of Victorian range etiquette and the discreet air of gentlemanly relaxation may suggest a less than serious approach to shooting, the truth is that from this field of match rifle shooting came major contributions to military rifle development, and more significantly, the Mark A 303 cartridge, which made possible the formidable long-range performance of the Vickers machine gun.
Right, gentlemen. In this way, please.
The Cambridge Club is what it seems to be, a collection of members ranging from 18 to 80. They still pay the same subscription fixed in 1862 at £2, and their annual meeting has an illustrious history. Pioneers of arms design like Sir Henry Halford, William Medford, and the late Lord Cotslow competed for the Cambridge Cup. Since 1880, Selwyn College has been the club meeting place. What attracts its members to the sport is the fact that all men start equal here. Just sufficient restrictions on rifle and ammunition means that not the man with the longest purse, but the man who puts most into the sport, in effort, in ingenuity, and in concentration, takes the prize. And youth has no advantage over age. Experience is all. That was true when the original Cambridge Cup was the prize. And that same criterion of absolute understanding of the art of shooting is still true today.
I will give this to Matthew.
Even at the beginning, the club had an electric scoring device. But that was not the limit of its ingenuity.
It was here in Selwyn College, Cambridge, that the Medford rifle made its triumphant debut in 1865. In fact, Sir Henry Halford, who used this rifle to win the Cambridge Cup that year, carried this section of the barrel on his watch chain for the rest of his life. Quite a fitting thing to do, because this rifle was so successful that it entirely dominated the military and the match rifle scene for almost the whole of the rest of the century. particularly as breech loaders, they swept the board. Here you have a match rifle, apparently, but it's really a military one. The bayonet mounting gives it away. These two are genuine match rifles, this one for the prone position and this for the back position. But with all the success that Metford's rifles attained in the latter part of the century, it's still interesting to recall that it was with this muzzle-loading rifle in 1865 that the Metford rifle made its debut here with the NRA. For in that year, collaborating with Halford, Metford won the 2,000 yards competition. The rifle is designed to be fired in the back position, and as you can see, it has a telescope sight. But the targets at 2,000 yards would be another half a mile further than those are from us today.
Gentlemen, you will blow off if you want to.
At Cambridge, it is permitted to foul the bore before taking up position, and the peerage version of the back position is certainly productive of results. The art of shooting this way up, supine, is to be relaxed and to transmit the weight of the rifle directly through bone contacts to the ground. You need not support your head this way, but most supine marksmen support it somehow. Shooting in the prone position looks easier, but has the real drawback with the long period spent on the point of causing severe backache.
Through the 1860s and 70s, the English, the Scotch and the Irish fired in the prone position with these match rifles. This is quite clear, the position of the sight is on the small of the butt. The American success in the back position inclined people in this country to do their best to achieve it themselves. Firing one of these rifles in the back position is not very comfortable, and an enterprising Scottish gunmaker, Alexander Henry, decided to produce the ideal weapon. He patented this design in 1878. It's a conventional prone gun in the one respect, but it can also be shot in the back position a deal more comfortably than most of the weapons that we've been looking at.
1866 at Wimbledon. Martin Smith of England awaits his turn to fire. Edward Ross, first winner of the Queen's Prize in 1860, will be next to shoot after Captain Heaton. 4 years have passed since Lord Elcho gave a shield for annual competition between England and Scotland. Today, members of the Eights still wear the same cloth badges, and the Elcho match continues as fiercely contested as ever. It has not always been so predictable. In 1907, the Ross rifle with its new pointed bullet ammunition suddenly swept the board. It was so successful that only 15 years after the end of black powder match rifles, it was necessary to introduce an inner scoring circle inside the bullseye. After the Great War, specialized cartridges were set aside as unmilitary, and the ordinary 303 became the only admissible cartridge. By 1936, the 303 was so accurate that the bull was further reduced to 30 inches, and the 303 remained the marksman's choice until 1963. This time, England has vanquished Scotland and Ireland. 100 years ago, the real opponent was America. In 1873, the Americans beat the Irish because one of the Irish put a bull on the wrong target. Most famous of all was the match of 1876, when the Americans beat the Irish, Scots, Canadians, and Australians. For a short time, international competitions were headline news, but by 1883, the era had passed.
The breech-loading match rifle used in these later matches was the Gibbs Metford Farquharson. And in this example, one can see how beautifully engraved the lock action is. Indeed, today we never see such work on our rifles. And of course, the block action has gone in favor of the bolt. Windage was applied to the foresight, as on the earlier rifles, and here there's a small bubble to get rid of any danger of canting. On the back sight, elevation alone was applied. One unlocked the eyepiece, adjusted the elevation, and locked it up. The last thing before firing was obviously to close the breech. The gun was a back gun and fired in the back position. A last look at the bubble, checking the elevation, and the shot was away. The 461 continued to be used until 1897. Then, With the services changed over to 303, obviously things had to change. Match riflemen put away their fine rifles and turned to service rifles. They had to use the round-nosed cartridges of service pattern, but they attached to the Lee Metford and other rifles fine sights of this kind.
It was in 1905 that optical sights were first permitted. Crosshairs are probably today the most popular foresight element. But there are still many who prefer a ring or aperture sight. The other lens is in the back sight. The telescope sight looks a better bet than the Galilean system, but is not without its disadvantages. Not only is it possible to get completely confused setting a telescopic sight, it's not recommended for the absent-minded, but it is easily deranged by an accidental blow.
The great success of the Lee-Enfield rifle in the First World War was a surprise to many. In fact, it was so successful that after the war, ideas of changing to a Mauser were completely abandoned. In between the wars, the rifle, the number one rifle as it later became known, was redesigned and eventually emerged as the number four. This is a number four rifle, and it is in fact the same rifle as went so successfully through the Second World War as the principal arm of the forces. The remarkable thing, however, is that in recent years, in the change in match rifle shooting to 7.62 caliber, some have continued to use the number four. And this particular rifle has won the match rifle championship three times in the last 4 years. So a rifle, which in theory at least is all wrong, it has rear locking lugs affected by the rain, it has a light action, shoots exceedingly well.
The Queen's final at Bisley is for all marksmen, match rifle, target rifle or service rifle. The summit of the year's shooting and a great popular occasion. Anyone who wishes is welcome to shoot match rifle or any other arm at the Imperial meeting. But it is the final 100 target riflemen in the Queen's who shoot it out at 900 and 1,000 yards for this most coveted prize. And the Enfield number 4 is always well in evidence. The tension is in marked contrast to the placid calm of Cambridge. Amongst the competitors from all over the Commonwealth, the spirit of competition is as sharp as a razor. The test here is one of eyesight, of physique, and above all, nerve.
Alexander.
The blackboards and scorers, the runners and telephonists echo the Cambridge Cup and the great international matches of the 1870s. But the speed of the modern bullet has rendered infeasible the Cambridge electric recording of 1864. But one thing holds true. The same Captain Heaton who shot at Wimbledon in 1866 wrote a book of advice for the match rifleman. Above all else, he commended an even temper. Should you make a bad shot at the commencement of the match, you should never lose heart. You should rather remember that finishing well after starting badly is a very satisfactory way of winning the prize.
Thank you very much, sir.
Really, really, congratulations.
The victor, rightly, is the man whose mind can triumph over matter. But it is no surprise that his chosen instrument was a weapon basically designed over 50 years ago.
Yes.
An Enfield rifle.
Well done.